I'd like to speak on atherosclerosis and thrombosis and plaque progression. This has been my passion for many, many years, and so I've devoted myself extensively in this area. So how do we move forward? So atherosclerosis is the leading cause of coronary heart disease, and atherosclerosis, that is hardening and narrowing of the arteries, refers to buildup of fat, cholesterol, and other substances in and on the arterial wall, what we know as plaques, which can restrict blood flow. Plaques can burst, trigger blood clot, and result in heart attacks. Most often, we consider atherosclerosis to affect the heart, but it can involve other arteries of the body, like the carotid, that can lead to stroke, or can affect the leg vessels, peripheral artery disease, that results in claudication, cramping, pain in the legs induced by exercise. This is a diagram to show what we know from the American Heart Association and our own work, that how plaques progress. When we are born, we have just intimal thickening in about 30% of us, that is known as adaptive intimal thickening. Type 2 is also known as fatty streak, or type 2, that is intimal xanthoma. Type 3 is pathologic intimal thickening. Type 4 is a fibroatheroma, which has a necrotic core. Type 5 is fibrous cap is markedly thickened. And type 6 is when we start seeing thrombus and the necrotic core rupture with a thin overlying fibrous cap, as shown here. Now, this is to show the actual histology. Those were diagrammatic, again, showing adaptive intimal thickening, pathologic intimal thickening. This is foamy macrophages present, that is fatty streak, pathologic intimal thickening, fibroatheroma, thick fibrous cap, and showing a plaque rupture. You can see the necrotic core has ruptured and there's an overlying thrombus. So how does this growth occur and what happens to the human being? If you look at growth mechanism, it is mainly thought to be through the lipid accumulation, and that leads to acceleration of smooth muscle cell and collagen deposition, and finally comes the stage of thrombosis. The onset is in the first decade, that is when there is growth through the lipid deposition, followed by from the third decade onwards, that is pathological intimal thickening, fibroatheroma, thick cap, and then from the fourth decade onwards, we start seeing complications. So clinically silent, clinically overt, and with manifestations. So heart disease is the number one cause of death globally and accounts for 17.9 million deaths worldwide in 2016. And the number is expected to grow to greater than 23.6 million by 2030, as long as we control COVID-19 today. Recent data show that nearly half of adults in the United States have some form of cardiovascular disease. About 18.2 million adults in the US have coronary heart disease. Deaths due to cardiovascular disease in the United States from 1900 to 2017. You can see the rapid rise from 1900 up to close to 1900 or 1990, as you can see here. Since 1990, there has been a decline in the number of deaths. However, in 2010, there has been an increase, as we're seeing now. We're in the phase where we're seeing now, of course, today, COVID-19 has overtaken and has become the first killer of human beings today on Earth, especially in the United States. Here is cardiovascular disease mortality trends in the US males and females. Again, showing from 1980 onwards, looking at 2010, you can see there was a rapid decline, especially in males, although it increased mildly in females, but has declined till 2010. Since then, there's been an increase as shown both in males as well as females, and we can actually see more rapid increase in the African-American race. This shows you the prevalence of cardiovascular disease in the US adults more than 20 years of age, by age and sex. You can see they've been divided into 20 years, each column, 20 to 39, 40 to 59, 50 to 79, and 80 plus. And you can see males are in blue, females are in red, males without hypertension in green, and females without hypertension in purple. You can see that majority of the people who have cardiovascular disease have hypertension, and it dramatically increases beyond the age of 50 years, almost doubling in numbers. And then, of course, also in the 80s, it has also increased. And so is the number without hypertension. It seems to be increasing over time. Now, if you look at the percent breakdown of deaths due to cardiovascular disease in the United States in 2017, coronary heart disease is the largest killer, followed by stroke, followed by heart failure, high blood pressure, diseases of other arteries, and other causes. There are a bunch of valves, other things that can also lead to death. So heart disease, advancing age, is the strongest risk factor for cardiovascular disease. Heart disease and stroke are the first and fifth leading cause of death in the United States, accounting for about 30% of deaths in 2017. After 40 years of age, the lifetime risk of coronary heart disease is 49% in men and 32% in women, according to the findings from the Framingham Heart Study. Now, cardiovascular disease and major causes of death in white males and females, if you look at heart disease, remains the largest cause of death as shown in all ages, followed by stroke and other cardiovascular diseases. After heart disease comes cancer, the most common, then followed by accidents, followed by also chronic lower respiratory disease, Alzheimer's disease being the least common, and other diseases, of course, being the least common. And of course, it varies by age, less than 85 and greater than 85 years of age, being higher in less than 85 and less in the older, because the population also decreases. So what can we do for ourselves to decrease this ominous prediction? Health is the most important gift we possess in order to be successful, to be a contributing citizen of the community. We need to take care of health. Most importantly, know our risk factors for coronary heart disease. These are age, sex, hypertension, diabetes, hypercholesterolemia, smoking, daily exercise being the most important. The biology of atherosclerosis, what are the factors that contribute? Aging, we can do very little about. We can control other things. Dyslipidemia also, we are born with it, but there are medications we can take. Atherogenic diet we can avoid. Lack of exercise we can avoid. We can stop smoking. Obese, we can stop eating and be less obese. As you know, as the population is aging, so is obesity rising. Genetic predisposition, we can do little about. Diabetes, we can control by exercising, high blood pressure, and I started with aging. All of these contribute to atherogenic changes within the arterial walls. So coronary heart disease risk factor consists of multiple modifiable and non-modifiable risk factors. Let's talk about the modifiable. Lipid factors, these are LDL cholesterol, ApoB is an important contributor, and some of the others. Non-lipid factors are smoking, obesity, physical inactivity, unhealthy diet, stress, diabetes mellitus, hypertension. And non-modifiable, of course, we are what we are. We're born with it, age, we can't stop aging, family history, race. And emerging trends are lipid-related biomarkers like lipoprotein A, inflammatory biomarker, C-reactive protein, interleukin, tumor necrosis factor, and biomarkers of hemostasis and thrombosis like fibrinogen, 1-Willebrand factor, coagulation factors all contribute. Now, the relationship between LDL levels and cardiovascular events rate by the presence of multiple risk factors. Coronary heart disease and diabetes is associated with the highest cardiovascular event rate percent, as you can see, much higher. followed by coronary heart disease, by metabolic syndrome, and the impaired glucose fasting test. And you can see here, impaired fasting glucose. You can see that's the second highest, coronary heart disease, as well as no metabolic syndrome or IFG, diabetes and no cardiovascular disease. And then no cardiovascular, no diabetes, you will have the least cardiovascular event rate will be the lowest. Now, I'd like to show you the progression of coronary heart disease. This is work that we have done and shown. You can see here, intimal thickening followed by intimal xanthoma, that is fatty streak, pathologic intimal thickening without macrophages, with macrophages, early fibroarthroma, late fibroarthroma, thin cap fibroarthroma, then there are causes of thrombosis. And we have nicely described that there are three main causes of thrombosis. They are plaque rupture, plaque erosion, and calcified nodule. These are other changes that can be seen, and I'll address some of these as we go on. It's a complicated slide here showing that there are ways how we reach the acute coronary syndromes, that is AMI, that is acute myocardial infarction, unstable angina, sudden death. This can occur from plaque erosion. It can occur from plaque rupture or calcified nodule. This all occurs through thrombosis. You can have instead stable plaque, that is heel plaque rupture, and fibrocalcific plaque. And these can also lead to sudden coronary death. So most of the acute coronary syndromes occur through thrombosis, that is acute myocardial infarction, unstable angina, and sudden death. I told you about coronary thrombosis, main cause being from plaque rupture. In about 60% of cases, there's a thin cap as shown here, it's ruptured, and there's an overlying thrombus in the lumen itself. And there is an underlying necrotic core. Plaque erosion is the second most common cause, occurring at 25 to 30% of cases. You can have either a pathologic intimal thickening with lipid pool underneath, or you can have a fibroarthroma underlying, but there's no communication with the lumen and you have an overlying thrombus. Here's a calcified nodule with an overlying thrombus, which can also lead to acute coronary syndromes. Now, severe coronary atherosclerosis, they can be unstable plaque or they can be stable plaque. This can be thin fibrous cap disruption, luminal thrombus, cap is infiltrated by macrophages and T cells. This is what is unstable angina, or also what is seen in plaque rupture, what is dramatically seen in plaque rupture is sudden rupture of the fibrous cap and an overlying thrombus. Stable plaque that is greater than 75% cross-sectional area, lumina narrowing, and there is fibrous tissue and calcium with minimal necrotic core. All this brown, black looking areas are calcium. So what do the risk factors tell us? What type of thrombus are we likely to get? So what we did was we looked at risk factor in the presence of acute coronary thrombus in 113 men who had died sudden coronary death. As you can see, smoking is a predictor of acute thrombus. Age was not, hypertension was not, and diabetes was also not. And if you look at total cholesterol, we got equal high levels in rupture and stable plaques, and HDL also was not significant. So the only thing which predicted was smoking. Smoking is a bad thing. Now, other risk factors and type of coronary thrombosis, in 59 sudden coronary death cases, there were 41 ruptures and 18 erosions. You can see total cholesterol was higher in those with ruptures and those with erosions. HDL was lower. This is a predictor of death. And what was the best predictor was total cholesterol over HDL ratio. You can see that there's much higher in rupture as compared to erosion. So your cholesterol makes a big difference, and the type of cholesterol also makes a difference, that is LDL versus HDL cholesterol. We also looked at women. We had about 51 women, And what we did was we looked at total cholesterol, HDL cholesterol. You can see the plaque rupture was associated with higher total cholesterol. Erosion was with lower. There was no difference in HDL. Age was a predictor. That is, the older a woman is, the more likelihood of having plaque rupture. And the younger the woman is, more likelihood of having erosion. You can see here, if you are greater than 50 years as a female, you are more likely to have a rupture. If you're less than, you're more likely to have an erosion. Smokers, you can see more associated with erosion. You can see the hypertension, although not significantly different. BMI was not significantly different, and hemoglobin A1C, that is diabetic status, was not. So if you look at over decades, the percent erosion decreases. It's more common in younger women, less common in older women. That is also true in men. Younger men, as you get older, you get less of erosion. So we have come up with an idea that there is a thin cap fibroathroma that is a vulnerable plaque that we can recognize, which goes on to rupture. It's a question mark here, but really speaking today, there are multiple studies that have come out which suggest that this correlation is actually correct. They were presented at the American Heart Association this year. If you look at this, thin cap fibroathroma is recognized by having a necrotic core. It has a thin fibrous cap, less than 65 micron. Cap is infiltrated by macrophages. Cap composition is collagen type 1, very similar to plaque rupture, except there's a discontinuity of the cap. Here, there is no discontinuity. So something happens that makes it rupture. So if you look at the mean number of thin cap fibroathromas, they also correlate with cholesterol, total cholesterol. If you have a total cholesterol less than 210, whites in deep yellow, blacks in not so deep yellow, and total population. Let's just look at total population. You can see cholesterol less than 210, very few. If you have cholesterol greater than 210, you will have thin cap fibroathromas more than one. If you have thin cap fibroathroma with a cholesterol 210 and a ratio greater than 5, that is total cholesterol, HDL cholesterol, you can see that the number of thin cap fibroathromas increases. And this is just shows all cases. Same way with women. If you look at women and severe coronary atherosclerosis, look at age, older women have more ruptures than erosions. Looking at older women, looking at glycohemoglobin, more ruptures after 10. If you have total cholesterol, more ruptures. And if you are a smoker, again, you see much more thrombosis. We have recently shown, this was in New England Journal, although not recent, I would say 2003, we showed that the cholesterol that is seen in necrotic core, we believe, comes from hemorrhage. And we showed that if you look at glycophorin A staining, which stains for the red cell membrane, as it increases the glycophorin staining, so do the plaques become more vulnerable. That is, thin cap fibroathromas have the most glycophorin A. You look at iron, which is a product of breakdown of hemoglobin, also showing that that hemorrhage is correlates with the iron, correlates with the vulnerable lesion. Necrotic core enlarges and macrophage also enlarge. And we believe all this hemorrhage occurs because of leaky vasovasorum, that is small vessels that are present within the plaque. We show that here that plaque rupture with mild stenosis can also occur and non-occlusive thrombi can form. This is a mechanism by which plaques progress from an asymptomatic to symptomatic phase. This is showing you this is a dye, this is thrombus, this is underlying plaque. You can see here's the site of rupture and you can see overlying thrombus. This can heal and this will lead to narrowing of the lumen. And multiple things like that happen and leads to narrowing. Here is shown the same data showing how we can show that narrowing is correlated with rupture sites. This was work which came out of Dr. Mann's lab showing that number of previous heel plaque ruptures, if there is less than 20%, 21 to 50% narrowing, or greater than 50% narrowing. This shows you a heel plaque rupture. There's a necrotic core, there's overlying new heel plaque rupture, and there's a thin fibrous cap, which has type 1 collagen as shown here. This is ruptured, showing that this was one time ruptured, and then a new fibrous tissue formed that is called heel plaque rupture. And you can see in those greater than 50% narrowing, the incidence is 71%. Whereas when you look at our work, we showed that if there's one rupture, two rupture, three ruptures, or four ruptures at a site, the amount of narrowing increases, suggesting that repeated ruptures are the source of how the plaques progress. So if you look at heel plaque ruptures in diabetics versus non-diabetics, this shows no plaque rupture, light blue, one heel plaque rupture, two heel plaque ruptures, and three. Look at what happens in diabetes. There are very few non-ruptures. The rest all show ruptures. Same way in non-diabetic, majority do not show a rupture. And the numbers that show rupture is only half. So suggesting that diabetics have more ruptures and their plaques are much more diffuse, which we know, and have much greater disease. So development of atherosclerotic progression to thrombosis, these are normal artery. This is asymptomatic atherosclerosis. It progresses over years and may lead to high-risk vulnerable plaques, which may progress in an unpredictable manner. They may thrombose, which may be asymptomatic, so you just see progression of stenosis, or it may be symptomatic progression causing stable or unstable angina pectoris, or symptomatic, here showing you acute coronary syndrome, unstable angina, myocardial infarction, and sudden death. Now, thrombosis in vein grafts. I want to say that, you know, we've been treating coronary disease with surgery, with bypass, and what does happen to bypass? Unfortunately, they're not immune from atherosclerosis. In fact, they get atherosclerosis fairly rapidly, more rapidly than it develops in native arteries. Shown here is progression of atherosclerosis in vein grafts, less than 1 year, 2 to 3 years, and 3 to 5 years. You can see foamy macrophages here, necrotic core formation. Here's intraplaque hemorrhage. Here's a thrombus that has formed in this. And this can occur within 5 to 10 years. And as I showed you, in native arteries, it takes 40, 50, 60 years before we manifest our disease. So it's very rapid in vein grafts because these vein grafts have endothelium, which is not so competent. So when you look at plaque rupture with intraplaque hemorrhage and angiogenesis, the same mechanisms occur. That is hemorrhage from these vasovasorum, fibrous cap rupture, and overlying thrombus as shown here. So this is a cartoon to illustrate arterialization of the vein occurs first, foam cell infiltration occurs. These are the foam cells showing you foam cells. Then these can form a necrotic core with clefts, cholesterol clefts, and then you can get a thin cap fibroatheroma with hemorrhage. This is hemorrhage again, and a rupture can occur and luminal thrombus. Or it can just be fibroendothelial proliferation, especially more than 1 year and at anastomotic sites. So here's a native artery with atherosclerosis, intraplaque hemorrhage on the top row, and vein graft before. You can see that they have much greater necrotic cores as compared to even native arteries. Native arteries don't develop that severe. They have more collagen, whereas the atherosclerotic vein grafts have much more lipid presence. So atherosclerosis in stents can also occur inside stent, what we've called new atherosclerosis. This is to show you the history. Here you show early on plain old balloon angioplasty, then came bare metal stents, then first generation drug-eluting stents. Then we realized that in 2006, new atherosclerosis is going to be a problem in these drug-eluting stents. This is a stent. This is loaded with drug medication on top. This is expanded. This is the narrowed artery. And this is expanded to show you can get same lumen before and after. So that's the advantage of, and the drug is there to prevent intimal proliferation or new plaque formation. Idea being that this intimal proliferation will not occur. When you had bare metal stents, we saw smooth muscle cell proliferation and matrix deposition. Shown here is actin staining. Shown inside these are the stented area. This is the new intima. You can see that there's a fair amount of new intima. And this just shows you the progression of that disease. So what we learned in the first generation was drug-eluting stents. They were thick. They were uneven polymer distribution. They had high drug dose. And that led to delayed arterial healing, uncovered struts, hypersensitivity, malapposition, late stent thrombosis, stent fractures, breakdown, and neoatherosclerosis. And we were the first to describe the presence of neoatherosclerosis. This is to explain to you what is neoatherosclerosis. You can see this is an artery cut longitudinally. You can see there's an underlying plaque. They put in a stent. This is the rounds are the stent, showing you stent. Here's the round showing you in cross section. Here's the stent showing you in an artery histologic section. And here's necrotic core. This is the necrotic core that has formed inside the stent, showing you inside. And so now this lumen is narrowed because of neoatherosclerosis. And here we show the first time we showed a comparison showing that if you had bare metal stents, it took more than 2 to 3 years before, or more than 5 years before any significant atherosclerosis formed. Whereas in drug-eluting stents, within 15 months, we could see this occurrence of atherosclerosis. So what I have told you here is depicted here, a normal artery, plaque progression through adaptive intimal thickening, pathologic intimal thickening, fibroatheroma, thin cap fibroatheroma, plaque rupture, plaque erosion, calcified nodule, or it can heal, lead to late fibroatheroma, heal plaque rupture, or can become stable plaque fibroatheroma. So in summary, what I've taught you is atherosclerotic cardiovascular disease, the leading cause of death worldwide today is COVID. Risk factors determine the extent of coronary heart disease in spite of ever-improving underlying understanding and treatments, and we have not eliminated coronary artery disease. Plaque rupture is the main cause, 65 to 70%, erosion 25 to 30%, calcified nodule in 2 to 7%, in acute coronary syndrome and sudden death. Native coronary artery disease develops over decades, while accelerated atherosclerosis is observed in brain grafts, in-stent occurs within months to years. Neoatherosclerosis is one of the crucial mechanisms of stent failure development rapidly and more frequently in the first and second generation as compared to bare metal stents. Further innovation is needed to achieve better long-term outcome of coronary stenting. Drug-eluting stents are a temporary solution and have not thus far improved longevity in patients with stable angina. Therefore, efforts must continue towards innovation to improve outcomes. In the meantime, optimal medical therapy, risk reduction must be emphasized for all at risk for coronary artery disease. Thank you so much for this opportunity.